What I do just to kind of get that going in my paintings, I'll start off with a little bit of a tone, a wet tone over the canvas. I have a little bit of dry gray tone on the canvas right now. Just gonna make up sort of a warm color. And yellow and red, just a touch of blue to make it a little bit brown. So I'm gonna just put a really light tone over the whole thing. Okay, so this is a very light tone. A little bit of painting medium added to it to thin out the paint. There's no white, so I'm keeping the white out of it for now. So I'm going to take some cadmium red light and cobalt blue, and maybe just a touch of yellow ochre. And make a warm shadow tone. To draw the still life. So that if I draw it out and I don't like it, I have to waste a lot of time, change it pretty quick. Drawing it out, the thing I like to keep reminding myself is not to put something right in the middle, because if you have something right in the middle of the painting, I just like to move it off to the left or the right. If it's in the middle, they end up staring at that object, and then you go on to the next painting because you don't know where to look after that spot in the middle. But as people, we have a tendency when we're looking at something and painting it to just want to do that automatically. So I've got the vase off center, got this here, I've got that red area there, I've got the lemon. So I think I've avoided that, maybe. I've got the top of the eggplant. That's kind of in the middle, so I might move that over a little bit. What I do is put a center line in so I can make sure that I get both halves. I'll probably draw my ellipsis. Try to draw the whole object, even though I can't see the bottom. I'm gonna draw it in. Even the ellipsis at the bottom. Just so I have it set in the right spot. mask in all my shadows, and I'm going to do it with the same tone, with a warm tone, so I can have that same warm shadow color and everything. So one of the, that color I put on first, it's a warm tone. When, if I'm outside, a lot of times I do it with like a gray violet. And you know, that's something, a lot of what I'm doing, I want to mention that I learned from Frank Mason when I started his class when I was 16 years old. And Ann Mason is here, Frank's wife. And I was outside painting near the hotel yesterday morning, and you know, I was outside and I was thinking about Frank and all the things that I learned from him, and how lucky I was to just come across him at an early age. You know, I meet a lot of people who come to take a class with me, and they're, you know, maybe retiring from their other job, and maybe they went to art, they went to college, you know, back in the 1960s, and they didn't find anybody, so they ended up not really being able to learn a lot of these basic principles that I learned from Frank. So I realize I'm very fortunate to have learned these things. So, and one of the first things I learned from Frank, you know, he talked about a lot about light and atmosphere, and so outside, a lot of times he would put a gray violet middle tone wash over the whole thing. That would mix into everything that you paint later and give it harmony and give it a feeling of the atmosphere, of the air that we're breathing. So on the inside, you know, the outside, you have that gray violet that's in all the water drops and the dust and everything. And inside, because of the, you still have the same atmosphere, but you have a different color of light. All the shadows are warm, so I like to put the warm tone up first, and then that gets into everything and gives it harmony, gives it a feeling of air. So, in this situation, is, knowing whether your values are correct. So I put up a little piece of white here so that I know where white is. Also, I can use my colors to gauge whether I'm going too light or too dark. So I know that cobalt blue and cadmium red are kind of the value of shadow. So I can take those two colors, make a brown, and put that as my shadow. If I want to lighten up the shadow, I can add some yellow ochre, which is about a half tone. So I can also use that to, so if I take yellow ochre and put it right here, I can see that as a reflected light coming from the red up to the base. Start feeling it out. I'm working out of a mid-tone. I'll start to put some lights on now. just going to... Looks like a light.
Are you using any medium right now?
Yeah, I use oil and varnish mixed together, and I add dryer to it, and I change the amount of dryer depending on what I'm doing. So if in the winter and it's really cold and the paint dries really slow, I'll add a little bit more dryer. In the summer, the paint will dry quicker, so I'll have less dryer in it. If I'm doing an hour and a half painting, I want it to set up a little bit. I add a little more dryer. If I'm working on a painting for 12 hours in a day, like a big landscape, and I want to get as far as I can in one day, then I won't use that much dryer because... So it depends on what I'm doing. The
Terps and Damar?
Yeah, I use Damar, turpentine, and linseed oil.
None of the gels.
Excuse me?
None of the gels.
I don't use, sometimes I do. I like to do different things because you get bored doing the same thing all the time. So I will kind of mix it up a little bit. When I first studied with Frank, you know, I just wanted to concentrate on learning about color and all the things he was, so I didn't really get into the medium right away, and then that was around the time he got lead poisoning from being around the lead dryer all the time. So he said nobody could use the lead in the classroom anymore, so then I just didn't get into that whole thing. Frank kept changing what he did. He went from Maraget medium with the black oil, then he went to the sun oil and massive varnish mixed in with it, and then he went to the amber after that. So it kept changing. But I think the important thing is that you just, and everybody's different too. Everybody likes a different feel because we're all different. Some people want their different personality. You know, if you sit there and noodle your paintings and draw out everything, you take a long time. Then, you know, you don't really need a dryer, you know, because you're just spending a long time doing it and you want it to stay wet. If you have a personality where you really like to throw the paint up there, then maybe you need more dryer. Said if I take alizarin crimson is an accent dark, so I can use that on my darkest underplanes, just to establish where, they are. So if the alizarin crimson looks red, that means my painting's a little dark. If it looks, if you can't see any color in it, it's looking a little red, so I might be on the dark side.
How close are you to the Mason or Dumont palette for Scuro?
Excuse me? How close?
Yeah.
Well, it's basically...
Mason's palette is very similar to...
Well, I put the shelves here, and I don't have any strings of colors mixed up, but it's all in my head. So what Dumont developed, the...
Prismatic.
The palette is a teaching tool, so he could explain to people how to mix all these colors and get a good atmosphere. And so the important thing are the principles. And so usually the principles are like the warm light, cool shadows, or cool light, warm shadows. Massing. Massing is where you mass all the shadows in with the same tone depending on the distance that you're working from. So I would mass the shadows on a group of trees in a barn a mile away with a different tone, a lighter tone, than I would mass something in the foreground that would be darker and warmer. And there's also a progression from the sun away from the sun. So it's warmer colors closer to the sun, let's say in the sky, you have more of a cerulean or manganese blue. And as it gets away, the progression gets cooler. So warm to cool in a progression. In this case, I'm trying to simulate a north light cool color, so I have a cool light bulb in there. And the progression will be cool to warm inside. Dumont taught for 60 years, and the palette he had in the 1890s was different than the one he had in 1950 that he mixed up. So he changed it all the time. If you talked to the students that studied with him in the 1920s, they had a little different palette than when Frank Mason and Arthur Maynard studied with him in the late, in the 1940s. It's a little different. It was different, when John Carlson studied with Dumont in the late teens, early 20s. What I want to be doing is, as I mix up, let's say this green here, I'll start off with the shadow, add a touch of red to it to warm it up. Some thinking warm shadows. Another principle is planes. So my plane here, the table, is a flat plane, and it's going to catch more light. So I'm just going to start. I've got some white with a little bit of blue. And I'm just going to mass in this light plane. Thank you. was outside, that would be the ground plane. And the first, I think I met Frank once with my dad. We went over to the rental there. What was the hill? I forget what the hill was, but we went up there. We met Frank and briefly, and Frank was painting, and it was really nice to stop because my dad wanted to, you know, pepper him with questions and everything. And so then a couple days later, it was first class, and you know, everybody was set up. The Misty Meadow Horse Farm on this road, and I'm painting away for about an hour. Frank would come along a little later and work on take you know, look at the paintings and maybe have a few of the students here work on their painting a little bit, and other students would follow. So, and I really didn't know how the routine went because it was my first class. It was a sunrise class, and I'd gotten there before sunrise, like I was told, and I worked for about an hour on my painting, and I didn't know anything about painting landscapes, and I was painting, trying to paint every, you know, tree on the mountain and every leaf on the tree, and then every, you know, the grass. I was doing my best, and as I was doing it, I heard this, like every once in a while, I hear a loud laugh in the distance, and as, you know, it went along, you know, it was like every 10 minutes I hear this, and it got a little louder. So, and then finally, you know, I could see Frank coming, and there was maybe 5-10 students following him, and he finally gets up to my painting, and he said, "Do you mind if I, you know, show you something?" And I said, "Oh, no, not at all." He took a couple brushes, and he said something, and he wiped out my entire sky, like in two strokes, like boom, boom. And then he said something else, and he wiped out the whole middle of the painting. And then he said something else, and he wiped out the entire bottom of the painting, and he left like one little spot. He's like, "I'm gonna leave this here so you can see the difference." And then he handed me my brushes, hit me on the shoulder, and laughed, and walked to the next person. And the thing is, I, you know, and it sounds like a mean thing, but I'll never forget what he taught me that day. He said that, you know, the sky plane's light, you know, and that morning I didn't know what he was talking about, but later, you know, I figured it out. The sky plane is the lightest plane most of the time. The upright planes, the mountains and the trees are darker, and then the ground plane is light. So, and the reason why I'll never forget it is because, you know, he did that to my painting, so. So here's the ground plane. Right here. And the upright plane is the front of the box or table. So I'm going to set up the light so that it puts it in like a half light, a little bit of a shadow. I'm going to take a real warm tone and put it here just to make, even though it's catching some light, I want it to be in shadow. I want it to be dark enough. So that's the difference in plane. This is an upright plane, so the shadow's dark. Upright plane, upright plane, upright plane, upright plane, cat shadow. So I'm going to mix up a color for the eggplant, add some white. Keeping it, try to show any little blues. I want to show that the light is cool. Okay, I can mix up some green and take cadmium yellow light in cobalt blue, and make like a middle value green, and then I'm going to add some white and a little extra blue. I could add gray to it, just to show the gray-blue light. So that's a blue-green showing the pool light coming down from the sky. And then just add a little yellow ochre for the light on the eggplant. I took a little bit of alizarin crimson, which is a cool red, and painting in the light side of those red onions with that cool red. The danger in thinking about cool light coming in a room, the danger is, let's say if you're painting a person or something with a lot of color, is that you end up with a lot of gray skin tones or gray feeling. So you, in order to counter that, like, I want it to be cool, but I still want to have a lot of color. So my half tones, I'm going to add whatever the local color is. So here, just a little bit more red in my shadows and half tone. The half tone is the area where the light goes into the shadow, and it's not really affected by the light or the shadow. So it will have a little bit more of the pure color. So if you're painting a portrait, you know, that somebody's the light is going into the shadow on like right on that shadow plane, you get that pure color, whatever the object is. Putting in a couple highlights just to show, just so I know where my highlight is. And I've just taken some white and some blue. Radishes. Just going to draw them in. Add just a touch of that blue and white, draw in the light hitting the radishes. Back in the shadow side. Again, everything's that the yellow-red that I put down in the beginning, brownish tone is mixing in with all these colors as I'm putting them down. The light on the cloth, then I just can make a light gray or just some blue in there. And even though this is only 18 inches from the front of the table to the back, it's going back in space, and I can use my colors to do that. And the principle of warm colors come forward and cool colors go back. And you have a green leaf, and it's green only right in front of you. Once it goes into the atmosphere, it changes. So if it goes back, the leaf goes back 50 feet, I have to add a little bit of blue and white to send it away. And then if I want it to go back a half a mile, I'll have more blue and white. Finally, the green leaf, when it's on the mountain in the distance, almost looks blue. Because what happens is the yellow and the red come out as the blue part of the light spectrum. The blue overpowers the yellow and the red and keeps coming back stronger and stronger. And the yellow and the red are just overwhelmed by the blue that keeps coming back. So I can do that on a still life too. And I can do it on a portrait. I can make the head turn by adding a little bit of blue and gray to the object. I can take blue, a little extra blue, and send this back in here. Blue and white or gray and white, and anything cooler than the object. I can take the blue and send this part of the vase away. And on the alternative, some of these shadows from the texture, the pattern that's on the vase, I can warm those up as it comes forward. So I can take the yellow and the red. And wherever I have a shadow, I can make it stronger and warmer as it's close. So when I'm in the studio, I have a turntable. I listen to albums. And you have to turn it. You have to change the album every 20 minutes. It forces me to get away from the painting, turn the album, and step back from the painting. Because if you're up close all the time, you can only see what the painting looks like here. So what I try to do is every 20 minutes, just force myself to go get a cup of tea and then come back with a fresh eye. Coming in from the right. I can take some blue and white. Even though I put this into shadow, I could just have a little bit of blue and white up here coming in to show that light source. Same way the sun overpowers the sunny side of the sky with a warm tone. And as I go back over here, I'm going to lighten that background up. And I could add some yellow ochre or something warm on this side. And the light, say the light's hitting here. This is in shadow. This part here, I want it to be a little bit cooler. So I just, add a little bit of blue and white remember one time Frank did a painting, he was working on somebody's painting, and he was talking about Vincent Van Gogh, and he was doing it all in these Van Gogh strokes, and it looked pretty amazing, because you could see each stroke, and he had a purpose for each stroke, and then he said, but, you know, that's not my style, and just, you know, pulled it all together, but all the, it was all there, but it was just mixed together. And he said, now no one will ever know what I did, but it was all there, so. So the light's coming down and it's hitting right here and bouncing into the bottom of that vase, and it's making this part here a little cooler, and I could go with a cool yellow, like yellow ochre, or I could actually add a little bit of blue. I'm seeing blue there, so I might as well put it in. Now, if I want to check when you get into a painting, you start seeing the edges, and sometimes the vase starts out straight and start leaning like that. And when your way to check it is to look at it in the mirror, or flip it upside down, whatever, or you could redraw it. And I could just put a center line down here, just to check. Make sure. Orange carrots take some yellow and red, make orange, and then add blue and white to show the cool light. The next carrot, I could add a little bit of cooler, even if I wanted to show it going back. Thank you. So, you know, over the years, people have said, "Oh, I like your brush strokes a lot." And when I was starting out painting, and I was in a museum looking at Franz Hals, and I looked at his brush strokes, and I wondered, how did he know to do this brush stroke and that brush stroke, and it would work so well that when you stood back 20 feet, it all pulls together. And what I, you know, as I learned more and more, I realized that it wasn't the brush strokes at all, it was the color and the value of the brush stroke next to the one that it was next to. You know, dark, the halftone, the light, and the color, and then so the thought behind the brush stroke is more important than what the actual brush stroke is. A little bit of it's drawing, but if you have the color and the value right, then it's going to look good no matter what the brush stroke is. So whether it's like a, you know, pointillism with a dot, or whether it's a broad brush stroke, or it's blended together, if the color and value is correct, then it'll look good. And whether you paint it loose or tight depends a lot on your personality. Send this away, just add a little bit more blue and white to the back part. Come forward a little bit more. Warm tone. And then as something gets close, this corner of the bread, it's closer, so I can make the brush stroke a little bit sharper as it fades, you know, soften the edge as it goes away. Leave this edge soft here. Mm-hmm. And then I want that to turn this edge here. I would like that to be more of a little bit more dramatic, so it comes forward. So as I'm refining the painting, I'm still thinking about all the things I've been talking about. Keep like the principles just keep running through my head, you know, cool light, warm shadow. And the trick is that, say if I'm outside painting a landscape and I'm thinking about warm coming forward, cool going back, warm coming from the sun, going away to be cool. And so I've got two different principles that I'm doing at the same time, which you know, since I've been painting since I was 16, I just comes automatic to me. But that's what's harder for the person who's just learning these principles, because they can only kind of think of one at a time, and it just, you know, I sometimes I'll teach a workshop, and at the end of the week, you know, everybody's got a headache because they're trying to think about this stuff so much. They just get a glazed look on their face, and it takes time. It takes about 3 years of practicing these principles to get it into your painting. So it takes a while. It's like, you know, you can't learn to play a piano in a month. You have to practice over years, and the principles just seep into your painting and your knowledge. You get it, you know, as you, the more you paint, the more in depth you understand them. So as I'm putting more paint on now, the lights, I could put more paint, and it will help show in the lights that light hitting it, the thickness of the paint will add to the effect of the light coming down and hitting the object. So I taught a landscape class recently, and I'm talking about all these colors in the sky, and it's a gray day. And I'm saying, this color's here, that color's there. And people are saying, you really see all those colors? And I said, yeah, it's you pretty much paint what you understand is there, and you can see it once you know what to look for. So you're kind of telling your mind what to see. And depending on what you're telling your mind to see, pink in the gray or green in the gray, let's say a gray trunk of a tree. A lot of times it's gray, but I'm looking for the pink or the green to put into that gray to add color. So you can almost talk yourself into seeing anything you want, which is good because you can change it up from painting to painting. You're not always seeing the same thing. But those principles allow you to look at a blue sky and see the warmer tone closer to the sun. Some days you really can't see it, but you have to put it in your painting in order for the viewer can understand what's happening with the light. So as I mentioned in the beginning, I don't want to put something right in the middle. Like, you know, is that in the middle? You know, I guess it's a little to the left side, I want that in the middle. It's the same thing with the light. I don't want the light right in the middle. I don't want the light in the corners. So the source is here, in a that's coming down and hitting. So maybe I would have, there are places where you can put the light where they work. You can put them on a flat surface. So let's just say it comes down and I could warm this up a little bit. I put a little yellow in there. And then, so I've got, it's coming down, it's hitting here. And then maybe I'll have it, you know, hit on the corner of the bread or something. Or, you know, wherever. Usually with the highlights, I'll add a little bit of blue to the white so that you can see the cool in the highlights. One thing I do all the time, especially when I'm trying to see the value, is to squint my eyes down. So I'm squinting, you know, looking up there, trying to see the value and the color. And I might kind of open my eyes up a little bit more towards the end of the painting when I'm trying to see more detail, but the squinting my eyes eliminates the detail, so I can just see the overall color. Value. there's always color on my brush, so that's kind of know what I did for my last brush stroke. So when I add, sometimes I'm just adding a little bit of warm and cool to it. So I was painting this, I was trying to warm that up a little bit, and then add a little bit of the blue and white to send this part of pure black back. So with the brush stroke, sometimes I'm pushing the color in, sometimes I'm laying it on top, sometimes I'm mixing it. So, you know, you can have one color on your brush and do 100 different things with it, depending on how much pressure you're pushing the paint into the paint that's already there, or laying it on top. And having the dryer in there helps me to lay something on top of another color without it mixing in. Spend 15 minutes looking at the painting, not putting any brush strokes on, so that I can decide what I want to do next, or if it needs anything at all, look at the mirror or whatever. And I'll just imagine, oh, what happens if I put this in or that in, or many times in a landscape, it's just, I need to put a figure in somewhere, it just needs a feeling of a scale, so I'll put a figure in, and I might put that figure in 20 different times and keep wiping it out, because, and it might just be two brush strokes, but it has to be the right two in the right place. So I'll spend a lot of time at the end of a painting just looking, maybe taking it off the easel, putting it in a different part of the studio to get a different light on it, turning it upside down. Go find some kid next door to bring, have them look at it, say, what do you think's wrong with it? You know? one time I was painting in public gardens in Boston. I was doing what they call the fresh paint fundraiser for the Coppa Society. And I got there at 5 o'clock in the morning. I'm painting the sunrise, and I'm working on it for about an hour and a half, and this little Asian woman came up and was standing behind me, and she wasn't saying anything. She just kind of had her arms like this, looking at my painting. And she didn't speak any English, and I didn't speak any, wherever she was from, I didn't know, I couldn't find out. So I looked at her and said, good morning, and how are you? And she looks at my painting, and she comes up to my palette, and she points to the yellow, and she goes, dee, dee, dee. And then she like points to the sky, dee, dee, dee. So I was like, okay, I guess I need some more light in my clouds. And so I put some white and yellow, and I put it up there. And she stood back and looked at it some more. And she went up, and she goes, dee, 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 dee. And so I put one more spot in, and she goes, and she walked away. I got a critique, you know, that I needed. So yesterday we had a great day. I got up in the morning and I painted, staying over near Cooper Square, and I painted just around the corner from the from the hotel. It's a nice little scene, and a woman came along. She said, "Oh, that's beautiful. It reminds me of Paris." You know, it's kind of touching because of the bombs that went off in Paris the other day. And then Liz and I went shopping, and I brought my paints because she likes to go shopping, and she might spend an hour and a half in the store. So it's like perfect. I'll bring my paints. And so the first store I went into, you know, we hadn't gotten to a spot for me to paint yet. So I'm just kind of standing there looking across the street, thinking whether I want to go come back to eat lunch here, you know, at this Mexican place across the street. And so Liz ended up buying a couple things, and the woman, she told the woman who was helping her out that I was an artist. So she said, "Have you been to the Elizabeth Street Gardens?" And I never heard of it. So she goes, "Well, it's right around the corner, and you'll like it. There's all these big statues, and you know, there's an antique store that sprays out onto these gardens," and it was an empty lot. And people in the neighborhood came, and they started to fix up and make it into a park. And yesterday they were all raking, and they had the kids there, and it was this beautiful park that they're afraid they're going to lose now because the city wants to take it over. You know, make low cost housing there. You know, it's kind of a shame because it's beautiful green space there. And so the one woman came up, and she was talking to me, and she said, "They're, you know, she thinks they're probably going to lose it." And I said, "Well, you know, Frank Mason fought the highway going through down in Little Italy, and they won." I said, "You never know, you know." So hopefully they will be able to keep that space. But anyhow, I did a painting there while Liz shopped. I had a good trip down here. I live in West Swansea, New Hampshire, which is a small little quaint New England village. Across the street from my house, there's a community church, and down the street, about a quarter mile, there's a covered bridge. So it looks like something straight out of a, you know, Norman Rockwell or Courier and Ives, that type of thing. There's a little, you know, actually a river runs under the bridge, so it's a great place to be, and it's so peaceful. But you know, there's nothing like New York City to get energized, come and see art and see people. And so it's been a good trip. I do like to bring my paints and just get out and paint the streets, and I take photographs. So sometimes I'll go back to the studio and I'll use the study and I'll use the photograph and I'll do a big, like, you know, painting like this I did from a photograph, and it was a daytime scene and I didn't like it, so I made it into a nighttime. Well, I made it to a snow scene first, and then I made it into a night scene. So I changed it three times, and then what I like about doing paintings like that is when I first started doing New York, I thought, I want to paint New York like it's a landscape, like not that it's a city, but it's a landscape and it's the light, same principles that I use in all my other paintings. Just, you know, look at the buildings as trees, and when I did them, they ended up looking like cityscapes done in the 1930s and 40s. I mean, I didn't do it on purpose. It's just the way it kind of happened. And what's fun about, you know, once I get the painting done, then putting the people in, and the lights in the windows, and the sky, it just, it's all out of my head. What's fun about it is it's almost like you're a set designer for a Broadway play, and you're putting the actors in, and you're kind of telling a little bit of a story. So I really enjoy doing that. It's fun.
Yeah.
And you can, you know, when I made it into a night scene, I darkened the sky, and I, you know, my light effect changed. Yeah, well, a lot of times I just paint with one brush, and I'll just wipe off the paint onto a paper towel and leave some if I want it. And if I want the paint that's there, I just mix more paint with it. put it on. Also, the dryer that I put in to my medium started to dry the painting and enables me to keep the colors a little bit cleaner. But I'm always working I'm thinking about the air in the room as I'm painting. So just the fact that I've got all this paint on my brush and it mixes in with everything kind of helps to keep, for me to keep a harmony in the painting. So all the colors are everywhere in the painting. And the varnish itself helps to dry it. As well as the turpentine evaporates out of the varnish, it gets sticky and thick. So it just gives the brush a little bit more drag. And I think mediums, it's all personal. It's what you like, what you get used to.
At one point, you had talked about you put another certain color on to judge a value next to it. And you said if it's too red, it means something.
So I'm going to take alizarin crimson, and I clean my brush off a little bit, and I'm just going to put the alizarin crimson like under this carrot there. Or put it here as an accent tone. Maybe it doesn't work there, but it's okay there. And I'm not saying that as being too red. If it looks really red, my painting's too dark. If I take yellow ochre or cadmium, I tend to use the yellow ochre because it's a little more neutral, but if I take the yellow ochre and put it somewhere, changes color. I don't know.
Dye?
I'm not sure.
And permanent.
Yeah, as far as I know it is, but I could be wrong. I don't use a lot of alizarin, so I don't really worry about it. Mostly what I'm using it for is to test, as a test, and I will use it in some violets in the distance, and I haven't noticed anything in my paintings that I don't think my colors have changed since I started painting when I was 16. And I still have some paintings that look the same, so it's probably okay. I know some artists don't use umbers because the umber does dry painting out. Frank, I kind of do the same thing Frank did. I use the cadmiums and blue just to make my browns. And I do use yellow ochre, which it's not an earth color. It's actually, it's not made with, the yellow ochre that I use is yellow oxide. So it's not a earth color.
What kind of paints do you like?
I generally anything that's, I'm not too picky. As long as it's pure pigments, I try different whites, but I tend to go with Utrecht paint because I paint a lot and I use a lot of paint, so it's pretty inexpensive. It's good paint. I like it.
Do you mostly paint landscapes or?
Landscapes and figures and still lifes. I like being outside painting, so the landscapes are fun for me to paint, and I've always had a talent to paint people, so I try to paint people as many times as I can. I don't like still life as much, but I do them, I think of them more as practice when I'm painting them, and it's not as gratifying to me. think, because even when I'm doing a landscape inside, I feel like I'm outside. I've done a lot of Irish kind of pub scenes with different characters. I do some religious paintings once in a while, but I'm just always trying to get that into my daily routine is just to do more paintings of people. So I probably do more landscapes though than I have in the past. There you go.
Thank everybody for watching this beautiful demo.